Look at somebody this morning and say, fix your focus and your purpose. Now everybody in this life has a purpose. A lot of times when things happen to us, we wonder, why is this happening to me? Because there's a purpose for it. There's a reason for everything under the sun. Somebody say amen now. We are driven by our purpose. Some people are driven by their guilt or their resentment. Some people are driven by their purpose of anger or fear or materialism. Or some people are driven by their purpose for need for approval. Sometimes you can't get folks approved. Sometimes people ain't always in agreement with what you do. Well, come on, somebody. Let me just note here this morning, knowing your purpose gives you meaning to life. Now, if you ain't got a pen and pencil, you might want to write some of this stuff down, but knowing your purpose in this life gives meaning to your life. Because I can tell you, you and I were not put on earth to be remembered. If you think you want your name up in the neon lights, or somebody want to be remembered as the world best preacher, or want to be world best singer, or world best prayer, or whatever, you're not put on earth here to be remembered. You're put on earth to prepare you for eternity. Did you get that right? So if you trying to sell to be something high and mighty in this life, forget about it. Forget about it. Try to prepare yourself and focus in the purpose that God has called you in this life to do. Whether you get anybody approval or not, it's not important. What's more important than getting man's approval is getting God's approval. Y'all ain't ready for this message yet. You might not like me after the day, you know. Because see, when I get beside myself and I've been fasting and praying, there's some things that I see that I just go and sharpen my sword. I said, I can't wait until Sunday. Well, y'all ain't with me right now. You can get mad with me and you really don't matter to me, you know, because when I realize I take a position and a stand on something, I realize that my mom and daddy won't agree with me. Y'all ain't with me right now. They brought me in this world. So you have to understand that I learned one thing in life. Once you get focused, once you fix your focus, once you find out what your purpose is in life, you won't let all these things that you see with your eyes and you hear with your ears bother you anymore. If the children want to act up, go ahead on. You ain't God's head anyway. If nobody want to talk to you, so what? Amen. I ain't here on earth to please no man. If I can't please God, I'm in most biggest trouble you can ask me. Amen. Amen. I look all of you today. I got to see what my wife say. I got to see what my husband say. I didn't say we can't be in agreement. But when it comes down to the gospel, you can't compromise. Come on, somebody. If a man or woman would involve themselves into lesbianism or homosexuality and you try to get them to turn around and they refuse to turn around, God, have your way. Because if the Holy Spirit and the Holy Word can't change them, ha, you're wasting a lot of energy and time trying to make them saved. Yeah. Look around at somebody and say, you can't save nobody. You can't save nobody. No. If God can't save you,
God can't save
you. You can't be saved. You have to thank God that God has called you to fix your focus.
Amen.
And a purpose in your life.
Yes.
You have to understand that knowing your purpose will simplify your life.
Yes.
You hear me say, I live a very simple life. I don't need the drama.
Okay.
Look at somebody and say, one thing pastor don't need. Is the drama.
It's the drama.
Keep the drama to yourself. I don't need no drama. I don't need no acting out. Some of y'all been winning Academy Awards. on, somebody. You see, knowing your purpose will simplify your life. Knowing your purpose will cause you to focus on your motives. Knowing your purpose will prepare you for eternity. You were not, once again, put on this earth to be remembered. See, you can do some famous things. I don't care nothing about the Hall of Fame. I'm talking to you this morning. That ain't going to mean nothing. Because the question is going to be asked, what did you do with my son's Jesus' name? What kind of answer are you going to have for the Lord? Because every last one of us is going to have to stand before God Almighty. It won't be no ifs, ands, and buts about it. He's going to ask the question, what did you do with my son's name? You see, the devil is mad with you. If I can get in your head, he's mad with you when you fast and pray and you set aside time to commune with God and to get your focus on God and find out what your purpose in life is. He's mad with you when your mind is like a powerful locomotive, when you're just going to go down that straight path and you're going forward to serve the Lord. The enemy is mad with you. And if he's mad with you, you ought to be glad. Because God got a crown for you. He has a blessing for you. So don't fall in that trap. Nobody cares for me. The world's against me. If they was against Christ, they're going to be against you. Get it in your thought pattern. Don't try to make this world your home. Look around at somebody and tell them right in the eye. Look around at somebody and say, you're only here. On a temporary assignment. Come when your assignment is up. Y'all didn't get that. Y'all just got hurt me. See, what I'm picking up is somebody mad in here. Somebody upset in here. Things ain't the way it should be. But you know what? I ain't changing my format. I'm going to keep preaching, and sooner or later somebody going to get the message. Sooner or later somebody going to shout. You need to be smart. I'm glad I'm passing you. You go in, I don't care. You know why? Because great as he is in me, that he is in the world. And it's Christ that died for your sin, not Pastor Watkins. I'm not preaching and proclaiming the gospel. And if your life don't shape up, if you don't find yourself focusing on Jesus, I find your life purpose in this lifetime, you will find your mind will be everywhere.
Amen. Amen.
Learn about this. Learn about that.
All right.
Don't get mad now. Prepare yourself for eternal life. Everything has a purpose. Look at somebody and say, everything has a purpose. You're a purpose sitting here. You may think that you're here because you're just here and, you know, mom and dad and other cousins all over the church. No, no. You're here for a reason.
Amen.
I want you to understand, according to the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 says, to everything, stay with me on this, to everything there is a season and a time. To every purpose under the heaven. Now I'm going to read that again. To everything. To everything. I don't care what's going on in your life, there is a season and there is a time to that purpose. You weren't just born because you was the twinkle in your mama or your daddy's eye. It was purposely planned by God that you be born in the hour in which you were born. Many of you could have been born 1,000 years ago, but God would have you be born and living in 2004. Because He has a purpose for your life. He has a reason for your life. And in every demeanor in life, whether you're born, a time to be born, there was a season and a time for your birth. That's why folks go to astrology and look up their sign. I'm born going under the sign of oppression. It says that I'm going to die in sin if I don't repent. I know that ain't no sign. I'm just trying to tell you. People look at that sign. Well, me and you compatible. Huh? The opposite attracts. It says that today I'm going to find the love of my life. You read them astrology, and you're going to find yourself messed up. You see, yes, the word says there is a season. Just like right now, there's a season when certain fruits and vegetables come out. There are certain seasons that fruit and vegetables don't come out. So there's a time to be born, and surely if you're born in this world, you're going to die. The word says you brought nothing in this world, and surely you're going to take nothing out. Now, the only thing that you can get while you're in here is prepare yourself for eternal life. Stay with me now. See, when you fix your focus, see, I work in the ophthalmology section. One of the biggest things we do is try to fix folks' vision. Come on, somebody. All kind of eye problems. Come on, somebody. Sometimes people who can't see in the natural, you may think because they can't see, they wouldn't have any eye problems. But let me tell you something. After a long period of time of being in darkness, that darkness started affecting the optic nerve. And when the optic nerve is affected by darkness, it affects the brain. And when it affects the brain, it affects your nervous system. So many patients that come in, long after they lost their sight, they have to have what they call a nucleation. That means a removal of their eye. Well, y'all don't know what I'm talking about right now. I'm trying to explain something to you. When people come to us, they have cataracts and glaucoma and age-related macular degeneration. It's an age disease of the eye. It comes with time. Some of it can be corrected and some of it can't. But all these people come to do is to get their vision fixed. Or their focus fixed. We find out what our purpose in life, you begin to sharpen the focus in on your purpose. You see, you can take a bright light and a magnifying glass. And the diffused light don't mean nothing until you shine it through the magnifying glass. And then it don't mean anything because it shines too, but the minute you get the right distance and the right point, all that power begins to focus. It begins to harness. And it can be so powerful, it can burn through glass, it can burn through paper. And even so, laser beams are so powerful because the light is so focused. Focused light can cut through steel. When you got your focus made on serving the Lord, you get so focused, and you're a devil in hell. In other words, the devil will come up, realize you're focused upon serving the Lord, and nothing ain't going to stand in your way. The devil just get to beside himself. And say, I ain't even used to even worry him today. So he or she ain't going to be bothering me. That's the kind of mind that God wants you and I to have. Y'all ain't saying anything. Maybe you're just listening to me trying to absorb things. But never confuse activity with productivity. Y'all with me on this?
Yes.
Sometimes you can be active doing all kinds of stuff in church. I don't see no production. Oh, y'all got me. Y'all still mad at me? You been fasting and praying that much this week, but you mad at me? Huh? If you ain't mad with me, raise your right hand. If you're not mad with me, raise your right hand. Some people say, man, what your name on man, give it up my good until I finish my fast and prayer. Oh, then I'm gonna give up my good. You just grooving with your grub. Grooving now. I'm mad with her, I got her. I'm mad with him, I got him. Don't work with me. My children will tell you in a minute, I don't care nothing about their attitude. My wife will tell you that. My brother and sister tell you that. Leave them alone. My mom got mad with me. I left them alone. My wife tell you, I grab my tools. I see you later, mom. Come on, somebody. I love her. I don't stop loving her. But I ain't got time for that drama. You want drama? Watch TNT. Watch the soap operas. Don't hand me that stuff because I don't want to deal with it. I don't want nobody to go home and say, Pastor told me I could watch soap operas. Some of y'all watching soap operas. Don't be reading your Bible. What did she do this week? The Holy Spirit, all week you've been fasting, say, lead them soap operas, Lord. The Bible said a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant. There's a season and a time to plant, and then there's a time when you pluck up that which is planted. There's a time to kill. That don't mean you go out and commit murder, because you can assassinate somebody's character. There's a time to heal. You can't be looking. Sometimes when the scab go over, sometimes when the scab go over, y'all hear me now? Sometimes when the scab grow old on the soil, leave the scab alone. Because it's healing in the process. So I'm going to go back and snatch the scab off. Oh, now, y'all look at me like I'm crazy. You know what I'm talking about. Let the healing take its place.
Yes.
The healing will start with the tongue. You speak kind words, sweet things gonna come out. Your focus is all about creating problems, you're gonna be a problem.
Amen.
Some of y'all just kind of looking at me. You know what? There's a time to weep. And then after that weeping, there's a time to get it all out. Laugh. There's a time to moan, and there's a time to dance. Yeah. See, there's a season and purpose for everything. There's a season and time for everything. It's a time to cast away stones, and there's a time to gather stones together. Just don't hold on to them stones too long, because they will weigh you down. It's a time to embrace. Come on, somebody. And there's a time you don't want to be hugged. Come on, somebody. There's a time and season for this now. There's a time to get, and there's a time to lose. Come on, somebody. There's a time to what? And there's a time to what? Cast away. There's a time to rain, and a time to what? Sometimes a time when you have to tear things away. And there's a time you have to sew things together. You can't keep tearing up things. There's a time to what? This for everybody. And a time to what? See, sometimes we get that mixed up. Sometimes we speak and sometimes we keep quiet. The time we're supposed to say something is the time we shut up. The time we need to shut up is the time we need to say something. And sometimes we get this all mixed up. There's a time to what? Always time to love. Look around at somebody that says, always time to love.
Always time to love.
And it's the time to hate. You know, there's some people say, I hate Pastor, he makes me sick. Oh, he's preaching on me and talking about me. I ain't talking to nobody about you.
That's right.
If the Spirit brings conviction, it's because He brings correction.
Yeah.
And because He brings correction, it's because God loves you.
Yeah.
And if God loves you, He said, I'm going to correct those whom He loves. That's because He wants to keep you from dying and going to hell. You got to keep that in your head. If all your friends and buddy are being shot up and shot at, are being stabbed and cut, it's time for you to make a change. You know why? Because it's a time of love, it's a time of hate, it's a time of war. We live in a day and time where there are warmongers. about you, but I'm disgusted with death.
Yes.
I'm disgusted with death.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but I can't stand death. Because it brings sickness and disease.
Yes.
It brings pain and affliction.
Yes.
It numbs the soul and numbs the spirit.
Yes.
It causes you to think things you don't want to think, because death will come and catch you unaware. So that I go to funerals and be involved in funerals, I just shake my head. See, in this country, we beautify death and make it look pretty. Put flowers in caskets. Spend all that money wondering who's going to die next, who's going to live next to die. I'm here to tell you, we all can be on that list. Stay with me now. There's a time of war. And then there's a time of peace.
Yeah.
Why? Because you can't be warring all the time. You can't be fighting with your brothers and sisters. You can't be fighting with those in a position of authority all the time. Lead the preaching to the preacher.
Yeah.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
I thank God called me in the forefront. It ain't that I wanted it. It's just that it was my purpose.
Yeah.
I don't think I said that clearly. If you want these shoes, you can have them. But when you get these shoes, don't be coming looking for me down in Carolina on some quiet road sitting on my front porch saying, "Bro, Pastor, you can have your shoes back." Because when I'm out of here, I'm out of here.
Yeah.
I recognize my temporary assignment. When I'm finished with my boss man, I said, "Is that all you want from me?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "See you later."
Amen.
So when I'm finished with my assignment, I'm out of here. You might not have that same mindset, but I'm tired of this world. I'm sick of the sickness and disease and the affliction and the pain. I can understand why Jeremiah cried so often for the people of God.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
You feel the power is not my anointing power. Jeremiah understood that you fed the brain this week, that our righteousness was like filthy rags.
Amen.
Take a look at your life.
Yes.
And you have to thank God that He brought you into the family.
Yes. Yes.
He could have left you out there.
Yes.
What profit had he that worketh in there wherein he labored? Whatever man sow. You know, one of the most ironies of life, I don't care if you sow good things, you're going to reap good things. If you sow discord or mischief, it's the irony of life. The Bible says, "He that sow the wind will reap the whirlwind." God was trying to speak to y'all this week, and you won't pay attention. To show you what he meant when he said he took Hurricane Ivan out into the Atlantic, spin it around and brought it right back to Florida again.
Yes,
it
is. Yes, it is.
You think that's a joke?
Yes, it is.
Now don't get me wrong, I feel sorry for some of those in Haiti and the islands and Puerto Rico and all those places down there and down in Florida. But you see, God says vengeance is mine. And it might not seem right, but you see, God got out. There's a purpose for everything that's going on in your life. There's a reason.
Yes.
It ain't coincidence. It ain't by chance. God would allow it to happen.
Yes.
Once you got made up in your mind, focus.
Yes.
Fix your focus.
Yes.
Fix your purpose.
Yes.
Find out what God called me to do.
Yes.
And someday you might have to cut loose. Sometimes your activities you have to get rid of in order to be productive.
Yeah.
I didn't get no hearty amen this morning. preaching.
Thank you, Lord. Preach, preach.
I'm digging deep, saints. Some of y'all don't see me digging. I'm like a man in a hole right now. All you see is dirt going over my shoulder. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Talk to me this morning. You know I'm down here. I'm laboring.
Yes, sir.
This is not by some man wise divine. This is by God's design.
Amen.
Well, you ain't seen that yet. You ain't even getting this message. Y'all gave me a lot of time today. Hallelujah. When you get happy, you put your knuckles there and say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You got one of them good blessings. Put your hand together and say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Put your knuckles together and say, hallelujah. First Jesus said, I have seen the travail, the work, which God hath given to the sons of men, to be exercised in it. I've seen a lot of things in my short lifetime. And God has given men great vision and wisdom and insight to things that you could never imagine. He has made everything beautiful. Everybody say, beautiful. See, everything that God made is beautiful. See, at the time that he's trying to beautify you with salvation, it don't look like he's beautifying you. Because some of y'all don't want to go through what he's trying to do. Some of you want to fight and say, not now, Jesus, not now. I was doing so well. Why now? Because why not now? You ain't that precious and that pretty that God can't beautify you with salvation. But in order to get that beauty, you got to go through something. Sometimes God got to tear something down, brother, in order to build something up. Sometimes God got to get you together, something together, to have you to look at and say, I got to get rid of this. Sometimes you get all them things that come in your life that you want to hate.
Yes.
So he can show you the difference between love and hate.
Yes.
Somebody say amen.
Amen. Amen.
He has there made everything beautiful in this time. Also, he has set the world in their hearts. You know why he put so much of the world in your heart? So that no man can find out the works of God that God made from the beginning to the end. See, he would allow certain things to happen. Then he says in verse 12 and 13, I know that there is no good to them, but for a man to rejoice, somebody say hallelujah,
hallelujah,
and to do good in this life. So you put on earth to do some good things. You put on earth to serve us, not to be served. And you put on earth not to be remembered, but to prepare yourself for eternity.
Amen.
Some of y'all got it made. Look around the room, don't say nothing. Just look around in the room. Some of these folks got it made.
Some of y'all.
Got it made in the shade. Some of y'all don't even want to look around. Some of y'all just got it made. Don't say nothing, y'all. Just look around. Don't say nothing. Some of y'all got me, you don't even want to do what the pastor tell you to do. I'm trying to tell you to do the right thing. You don't even want to do that. Come on now.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
See, this is going to help you this week. You know why? Because when you focus in on this message and focus in on what God wants you to do, he's going to bring to our clarity in your mind the thoughts that you need to have. He said in verse 12, stay with me now, that there is no good thing in them but to be for a man or a woman to rejoice and to do good in his life. Verse 13 says, and also that every man should eat, drink, and rejoice, or enjoy, I'm sorry, the good of his labor. Why? Because it is the gift of God.
Amen.
God give you something to work with, you have to thank God.
Yes.
You have to praise God. Amen?
Amen.
If God allows you to see something, you have to thank God you can see it.
Yes.
Come on, somebody. If God allows you to walk somewhere, if God allows you to eat certain things, if God allows you to have a certain job or opportunity, it's because there's a purpose to that. There's a reason for everything that's happening in your life. When blind Bartimaeus was by the wayside begging, he was blind, couldn't see a thing. But just because folks are blind don't mean they can't hear. And one day the word Jesus was passing by and all the commotion was going on. And he grabbed one of the men and walked by and said, "What's happening?" He said, "Jesus is passing by." Sometimes Jesus is trying to pass by in your life. They're trying to get you to cry out to him because you're going through something. Some of y'all want to hold on to that what you're going through because you don't think God can deliver you. You make a sad mistake when you think God can't deliver you. If you want to be delivered, get your mind focused. If you want to be delivered, figure out a purpose in this life. I'm not going to do anything that's going to hold me back from my salvation. A bitterness, a resentment. Blind Bartimaeus said, "Jesus!" You can see Jesus going along. He heard it. Just like sometimes when y'all cry out to Jesus, "Jesus!" He said, "Have mercy on me." Yes. Things ain't going right in your life, cry out.
Yes.
If you learn to worship him and cry out, even when the devil's trying to put it on you, you should be hollering even more. Right. Even when things ain't where they should be, cry even more. Right. Even when things ain't fixed, God can fix it. Isn't it a wonderful thing to know? Out of all the vocations, our occupations that this life has to offer, God will allow Jesus to be born to a carpenter. You know why? Because a carpenter likes to fix things. You got something broken in your life? Call on carpenter Jesus. Y'all praise the Lord, the other one say, "I'm just thinking, throw another log on the fire." Let me think some more about that, what he's preaching about. Blind Bartimaeus understood, the only way I'm going to get my healing, I'm going to have to cry out. Sometimes the only way you're going to get delivered, the only way you're going to get that purpose in your life, the only way you're going to get your focus back so you can see, is you're going to have to cry out. Things in front of God. Boy, when I get educated, when I hit the lottery big, when I find the right woman or the right man, when I get over a certain age, I'm gonna come to you, Lord, and I'm gonna really serve you. Isn't it funny how some people, they don't call the Lord until they sick? Come on, somebody. said, what can I do for you? He said, Lord, that I might receive my sacrament.
Yes.
There's something wonderful about having your focus fixed.
Yes.
Something wonderful about seeing what God has called you to do. But there are a lot of folks today, I work with a lot of doctors, and a lot of them are blessed to be ophthalmologists. They're blessed to be optometrists. They're blessed to be licensed opticians and work with the human eye. But there are some of them, I wouldn't let them operate on my pet cobra. And I don't even have a snake. You know who's going to get bit trying to operate on cobra. I think y'all got the gist of what I'm trying to say. Keep him awake. Tell him you want another doctor. Come on, somebody.
I'm talking about what I know. I need something
to my
truth.
Amen.
Blind Barnabas received his sight.
Yes, yes, he did.
But one of the things I learned that the louder he cried out to Jesus, you're going to always have folks all around you. That may be in the church. That may be in your community. That may be in your household. They'll tell you, shut up.
Yeah.
Hold your peace. Be quiet. Don't say nothing. You're calling the Lord too loud. It don't get all that. Oh, yes, it does. And take all that in some. Well, look at it. Jesus is a pickle and a bag of skins and all that. If you can use the common language. He's sweeter. Every day he's sweeter than he
is.
Some of the brothers need to understand that, you see, the women, the sisters, they didn't call on Jesus because it's a man and a woman kind of thing.
Yeah.
But when the brothers call on Jesus,
all right.
And the sisters recognize. He went into his bedroom because things didn't go his way. He went and fell across his bed and started crying. Now, you know some folks, when they can't have their way, because they're focusing on the wrong thing. They got the wrong purpose in their mind. Am I saying amen now?
Amen.
And while they was in there boo-hooing, you know, people with the real good. They can't get their way, they just put on a show. Some things is not meant for you to have. Look around at somebody and say,
Some things
is not meant for you to have.
Not meant for you to have.
Sometimes you're gonna think so bad, it's not meant for you to have. When Jezebel came in the room, I ain't talking about how bad she is. I'm trying to tell you how diabolical. That's some trifling folks. Diabolical.
Mm-hmm.
She said, what's your problem? I understand. You ain't eating nothing today. What's the problem? What's going on with you, Ahab? And then you see him sitting up on the side of the bed. Going in that vineyard and he won't go. He won't give it to me. That's why I have to cry by myself. Come on, somebody. Crazy, man. Crazy, crazy. You see, when Nabal went on about his business, he put the king of Israel on notice. Ain't giving up that rightful inheritance of mine. Your mind got to be so focused on what God has blessed you with and gave you, you ain't giving it up for nobody.
Yeah.
I don't want y'all heard me this morning. Your mind got to be focused. Your purpose has to be written in the chronicles of heaven's delight. He ain't giving it up. Let Satan be warned and know it. When he come around your way, let him keep going.
Yeah.
He ain't changing. He ain't, no. Look, the devil can tell his cohorts.
Uh-huh.
Them demon spirits. Come on, boy. They used to waste some time. But that brother, let's just keep going. Let's skip this house today. Maybe we catch one of his sons and a daughter off of God. See, when they can't get to you,
amen.
Don't you understand this walk? When the devil can't get to you, you're going to attack your brother, your sister, your son, your daughter, your cousin, your grandson. You can be perfectly going, thing on, I expect something to happen. So that I'll be on guard. So when the enemy does come, I will be totally surprised.
Amen.
Not surprised, but totally surprised. Ahab was sitting up there crying, carrying on. You know these performances, you know. Jezebel said, well, what's the, come on now. Take on and get yourself cleaned up and washed up. Go in and get something to eat. You're going to have that vineyard. Don't worry about it. I'll take care of that. When people tell you they're going to take care of something, y'all ain't listening to me. Y'all kind of focusing on me. When people tell you don't worry about it, take care of it, be on the lookout. Don't leave your business for somebody else to take care of. Look around in the room and say, you better handle your business. Don't leave your business for somebody else to take care of. I don't care who's your doctor. If your doctor, you talking to him, or talking to her, and she ain't talking right, you better get a second opinion. Yeah. Now, I'm not going to reveal no names, but I was talking to a specialist, a neurologist, a neuro-ophthalmologist, a highly specialized doctor been in the field for 37 years. There was a doctor in our practice that he could not finish the program because he had some, quote, irregularities in his personality. Okay, one more time for y'all. He did not finish the program because he had, quote unquote, some irregularities in his personality.
Okay.
And this was a foreign doctor. I'm just saying this so you can understand where I'm coming from. And he said, wouldn't you know when we kicked him out of the program? Wouldn't you know that we put our jaw on the line and said, if you don't be put out of the program, then we're not going to work here no more. So the hospital administrator said, well, I guess we got to get rid of him. Well, this poor little fellow they kicked out of the program, he wasn't as simple as they thought he was.
Mm-hmm.
You got him one of them high-priced lawyers.
Yeah.
And he's suing these doctors and the hospital for $30 million. I know y'all said, mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
When you leave your business for somebody else to handle,
That's right.
I ask the question, how come somebody didn't pick up trying to be sympathetic?
Right. Amen.
How come somebody didn't pick up on this earlier? He said, nobody don't want to take a stand. See, by him taking a stand, it's going to cost him.
That's right.
It may cost you a little. It may cost you a lot.
That's right.
But it's going to cost you something. When you take a stand, it's going to cost you something. And when you leave your business up for somebody else to handle it, it's going to cost you. Stay with me now. Jezebel told some false witnesses, I want y'all to claim a fast. This is what she said. I want a fast proclaimed, and I want y'all to fast and set Nabal up on high. In other words, see if he'll blaspheme the king or blaspheme God. And if he does, I want y'all to condemn him and stone him to death. And she sanctified a fast. There are people that will falsely accuse you if it means cleaning their own name up.
Yeah.
There are some folks that will lie on the truth.
That's right.
Now, y'all don't want to hear that.
Wait. All right.
Line up, sir. They'll tell you, I cannot tell a lie, and then they pause and say, from the truth. I'm trying to tell you something this morning.
Yeah.
I ain't just started preaching this gospel. This ain't new to me. I've been dealing with a lot of problems.
Yeah.
But I'm here to tell you today, as much as you think man has changed, he still remains the same.
That's right.
The Bible says that these false witnesses set up Nabal on high, watch and observe him. And one of them said, didn't I hear him cuss God? He thought he didn't say something about the king. Y'all Nabal just cussed the king and just profaned God. Let's take him outside and stone him. And the Bible says they took him out, they rolled up, come on somebody, and stoned him to death. Sent word all the way over to Jezebel. Jezebel got word to her ears. That's how wicked she was.
All right.
I know y'all saying, you know, there's a lot of Jezebels in the church, but you know there's a male Jezebel too.
Yes, they do.
Right.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
God said, when Jezebel got word, guess what? She told Nabal, go on down now and get that vineyard. Nabal is dead. But you know what? God spoke to the prophet Elijah and said, get down to Nabal's vineyard. You're going to meet Ahab down there. And when Ahab come down, I want you to prophesy to him and tell him the wickedness that he done. The same wickedness that he done and his wife done, their body would be sprawled across the field and Jezebel's flesh would be ate by the dog and the streets of the blood would be upon the baby.
Amen.
God is not playing, saints.
Amen.
You might be playing church, but God ain't playing with the saints. You can let this message go in one ear and out the other.
Yes.
But you're going to be held accountable.
Amen.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know the story? I want you to understand that Ahab went to war to fight with Assyria.
Yeah.
And he convinced King Jehoshaphat, which was a righteous king of Judah,
yes,
to come and fight with him. He said, your people are my people, so you got to be careful who you're agreeing with. Look around us in the room and say, you got to
be careful
who you're agreeing with. Before somebody says, ain't that right, you better find out what that ain't that right is all about. You see, the Bible said when Jehoshaphat said, your men are my men, your people my people, your horse my horsemen, your spears are my spear, we're going up to war together. But before we go, is there a prophet? See, before you make a decision, you better get God's approval.
Amen.
Not man's approval. Because the 450 prophets that Ahab and Jezebel had set up, you know what they were saying? Yeah, God said it's all right. Y'all can have the victory. Y'all want to win. Go ahead on up there. Y'all got the victory in your room. That ain't always the case. He said, is there a prophet in Israel? And you know what Hezekiah said? Ahab said, yeah, there is one. But you know what? Just like some of the saints down in the community revival outreach ministry, I hate him. I hate her. Because every time he prophesied, he always prophesied against me. Stop and think about this for a minute. If I always go somewhere and there's always trouble where I go, is it the people I'm dealing with or is it me? You know who you got to look at first? Because everywhere you go, you have to evaluate yourself and your relationships. If you're a busybody or a troublemaker, wherever you go, whatever you do, it's going to follow you.
Amen.
Jehoshaphat said, I'll go with you, but give me a prophet first. They said, Micaiah, he's over in the jail. I preached about him before. This ain't nothing new. He said, he's over in the jailhouse. Yeah, I throwed him in there because, you know, he didn't know how to act right. I told him about prophesying against me and prophet against me. He don't know who he's dealing with. See, when your mind is focused on the truth, when your purpose is serving the Lord in truth and righteousness, people are going to lie on you. They're going to say all kinds of things about you. And if you don't have no friends, so what? You don't need man's approval. You don't need man's stamp, seal of approval. Just say, yeah, you're saved. Yeah, you come on in. No, you ain't saved. You stay back. You don't need man's approval. Kaya, he's over in the jail. He said, well, go get him and bring him in and see what he got to say. Hosea and I, he would just ride bucket. Get him down to the jailhouse. Now, let me tell you something, Micaiah. My name is Zedaliah, and every 450 prophets has prophesied that we should go up because we can win this war. And as far as I know, you better tell the truth, and the truth better be that we're going to go up and win this war. Right. Micaiah said, I ain't going to do nothing except what God tells me to do. We go on and get out in front of God instead of we holding on to our marbles.
Come on.
Now y'all give me a quiet. I told you, don't give me no hour to preach now. I'll get to you. Instead of we holding on to our marble, somebody else got our marble laughing at you. You upset and angry and mad and disgusted and busted and broke and about to choke and can't see. Come on, somebody. Those things ain't right for me. Come on, somebody. Can't get along just to get along. Come on, somebody. He said, I ain't saying nothing except God giving me. I'm going to speak truth, thus saith the Lord. And when he got up there, he said, go ahead on if you want to go. But God had revealed to me. me in a vision, you are not to go up. And Ahab said, see what I mean? He always prophesied ill things against me. Sometimes when God said, don't go. Sometimes when God said, don't be involved. Sometimes when God said, stay kissing.
Stay
kissing. Right. We don't go and do it because it look right, it seem right. It appear on the surface. You get convinced that it look like a duck, it quack like a duck, walk like a duck, it smell like a duck, it swim like a duck, it must be a duck. It could be a goose in your book. Everybody this morning. Well, you see, we're living in a day and time where Jehoshaphat understood that he won't be obedient, but you know that? Instead of heeding the prophet warning, he went on anyhow. All
right.
And they both were decked out in the king's apparel, sitting on their chariots. And you know what Ahab said, trying to get slick? See, God knows where you're at all the time.
All right.
Told Jehoshaphat, I'm gonna get out of my king robe. You put on my king robe, and I'm gonna put on regular prayer and go down and see what's going on. Trying to get slick. It don't pay to get slick with God. Oh, and you're too many strong people, man. You can get slick with me all you want. You can fool me any day of the week. You know what? You don't need my approval. It's God's approval. The Bible said, even when Zephaniah was standing there and listening to Micaiah, and Micaiah told the truth, you can see Zephaniah open hand slapping. God says what? Touch not my anointed. You know one of the things that scares me about the scripture? Is that very verse right there. When you've been anointed of God, and you touch God's anointed, and I say touch, I ain't talking about coming up to him touching somebody. I'm talking about touching in a spiritual manner. Where it afflicts or hurt or bring pain, you better be aware.
True.
Be careful when people mark. Touch not my anointed and do my prophets what? There are people who design their mind. I'll fix him, I'll fix her. You playing a dangerous game.
That's right.
Because you see, everything that you think God don't see,
he sees.
The Bible said he calls the light to illuminate the darkness. In other words, in pitch black darkness, God got eyes to pierce the darkness. So why are we trying to hide something? Why are we trying to be something we ain't? Why are we trying to carry on and care about this and care about that and being mad with this or mad with that, upset of this or upset of that? Oh yeah, I'm talking to you.
That's right.
Look around and say, oh yeah, he's talking to you. He ain't talking to me, he's talking to him. See, because this kind of preacher sooner or later is going to dawn on you. This ain't my purpose, this ain't my design to want to do what I want to do. It's God's purpose. And it's better if I do the same willingly than to fight or bluff a bit against the Lord. They told Micaiah, go back to jail. Feed him bread and water until I come back again. And Micaiah said, you're not coming back. Put him back on death row. There's a warrant out for your arrest. The devil got a death warrant out on you. You might not know it or recognize it. He's trying to kill you any way he can.
Amen.
Like y'all ain't had enough because y'all don't want to fix on our
focus. Preach.
You don't want to fix on your purpose. Word says that when they went up, think about this for a minute. This man put on old clothes to try to blend in with everybody else, thinking that he could not be sought out as a king. He took his armor bearer with him. Yet he kept on his breastplate, thinking that he would not be caught. Listen to this thing. The Bible said that when he came down and he was riding through his chariot, the Bible said that there was a stray arrow. Y'all with me right now? These arrows and these bullets, they don't have no steering wheels. That's why your purpose in life, if you see them old friends or somebody out there dealing with something, you know they ain't right. It's all praise the Lord. God bless you, brother. I'll talk to you later. God bless you. And keep stepping. You know, somebody might be out after him. And you stand there rapping. And next thing you know, pow, pow.
That's right.
And you're another statistic.
That's right.
You know why? Don't nobody get mad with me now. I'm going to tell you this. I'm going to be finished in a minute. You know why white folks don't want to come down to Roxbury? Don't get mad with me now. You want me to tell you why they don't want to come down to Roxbury, Junior? You know why? Because Roxbury got a black eye. I'm going to let you think about it. I ain't going to tell you the answer to that. I'm going to let you think about what a black eye. How do you get a black eye? Okay, then you think it now. Put your thoughts in motion. Think. Think a little bit. Come on, it ain't gonna hurt you. No problem with that. Just think a little bit. The Bible said a straight arrow came and caught him between the vexed. Can you imagine that? An arrow coming from nowhere. The vest he had on came through between the armpit and the vest and just broke him right through the heart. Yeah. Don't tell me God can't kill you any time, any day, any night, any day. He can kill you in your sleep. He can have you running in your sleep. Running, running, running. You running, running, running. And your heart pumping, pumping, pumping. Next thing you know, your heart runs. Don't play with God.
Thank you.
You don't.
Praise God. This is Pastor Watkins from Community Revival and Outreach Ministries. I trust that you enjoyed that wonderful service we just had, and I trust the Lord that it touched your heart and your spirit, and it also inspired your soul. But beyond just listening to a message, we also ask you to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And how you do that, you just simply ask and bow before Christ. And if you're willing to lay hands upon your TV or bow your heads right where you are or sitting, if you just bow your head with me and we'll pray the prayer of faith. Heavenly Father, we truly thank you for all things in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that you forgive us of all our sins and have mercy upon our soul. And that not only you save us, O Lord, from our sins, but, O Lord, that you would sanctify our hearts and sanctify our souls, as well as, O Lord, baptize with the Holy Ghost and that with fire. We accept you, O Lord, into our hearts and our life. We confess our sins, and we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that God raised him from the dead. And by believing and accepting this, O Lord, we claim to be saved in his holy name. We give thanks and praise for all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I trust the Lord that your heart is fixed with the Lord and that your blessing will be assured and that you'll come out and fellowship with us. And if not with us, your own local church in your area, and that God will be a blessing to you until we see you again. Take care and God bless. Bye-bye.